Oh my god, look at this.
We are studying though. We're learning about the Veterans Administration.
Well, you can do that silently.
Breaking news. We've just got word about the urgent primary care crisis plaguing the modern medical student and consequentially the entire United States. The Association of American Medical Colleges projects that by 2034, there will be a shortage of between 17,800 to 48,000 primary care physicians, leaving our growing population extremely vulnerable. This situation is highly pressing, and we've cleared our entire schedule to cover this topic. But before we get into the primary care crisis, let's find out just how much college students know about it. Leticia Delgado is live at the University of Las Vegas, Nevada campus to find that out.
Thank you so much for that introduction, Nia. The inaccessibility of healthcare is an issue extremely relevant to UNLV students. According to the national census, adults ages 19 to 34 had the highest uninsured rates of the non-elderly population. Let's put this in perspective. 43% of rebels are between the ages of 20 to 39. With these statistics in mind, let's find out just how much UNLV students understand about primary care. My name is Leticia, and today I'm on the field to find out how many college students and how many questions they can answer about primary care. We hope you enjoy.
We're on the field, hey! We're on the field, talking to random kids, we're on the field.
Alrighty, so first up, I'm here with Ramsey, who is currently a chemistry major here at UNLV. Ramsey, I have a question for you. When it comes to minorities, do you think that most minorities receive their health care from primary care providers or from specialists?
Would it be primary care providers?
Ah, that's correct. Good job.
Up next, I'm here with Austin, who's currently an exploring major here at UNLV. All right, Austin. So Medscape reports that plastic surgeons make the most money out of all specialists. How much money do you think they make a year?
They probably make around like 200 grand. I know that because a lot of women love to get their BBLs done.
Okay. Well, that is a really good guess and exceptional reasoning. However, plastic surgeons actually make about $500,000 a year.
Gosh, I was wrong.
All right, so right now I'm with my good friend Araya, who is currently a business major here at UNLV. Araya, I have a question for you.
Okay.
So what is a primary care physician?
I thought they were all the same.
All the same physicians?
Yes. Are they different?
Oh, yeah. So different physicians do different things. So a primary care physician is like the one you see whenever you go to the doctor's office. Mm-hmm. But yeah, good job anyways.
Thank you.
All right. Up next, I'm here with Jason. Jason, you're currently majoring in kinesiology, so I totally expect you to know this one. All right. So which of the following careers is not considered a specialty in medicine? We have A, endocrinology, B, dentistry, C, radiology, or D, pediatrics.
I'm going to go with C, radiology.
Ah, that's a good guess, but actually it's dentistry. So dentistry is not considered an actual specialty because dentists and doctors go to even like different schools and have way different training. But you did a really good job.
Ain't no way, bro.
All right, and right now I'm with a good friend of mine named Alex, who's currently majoring in microbiology. Alex, I have a question for you. What do you think the ratio for physicians to residents is in Tonopah? So for every one physician, how many residents do you think they are?
Oh, right, in Tonopah. You know, probably a good, like, I don't know, 1,000?
1,000? Well, that's a really good guess, and we wish, but the ratio is actually for every one physician, there's 3,000 residents.
That was close.
Yeah, all right, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
So right now I'm with a really good friend of mine named Audrey, who's currently a pre-nursing major. So Audrey, I have a question for you, and you should know this one since you're pre-nursing.
Right.
So what's the difference between an MD and a DO degree?
I think MD stands for medicine doctor, and a DO stands for like doctorate degree.
Not quite, but that's a really good guess.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. We're on the field.
It is becoming increasingly clear that college students here at UNLV aren't too knowledgeable about the primary care landscape. That's completely okay. This hour-long special is dedicated to making sure you, the audience, are informed about your healthcare reform and primary care facts. Clarisse Andrada is currently live at the Kirkcaldy School of Medicine with more information on this pressing matter. My name is Leticia Delgado. Take it away, Clarisse.
Thanks, Leticia. As medical students graduate, we are seeing less and less interest in the field of primary care. It is extremely important that we find out what the problem is and find a solution fast, because medical students are the future of healthcare. What better way to find out a solution than by talking to a future physician? Here we have medical student Savannah Daniel here for an exclusive News HCA interview. Savannah, tell me, what are your feelings about primary care?
I've actually always wanted to be a primary care physician. I think it's really beneficial to our healthcare system. But during my education, I feel like we didn't get enough practice in the clinic, so I never felt equipped to enter the field myself. There also was a lack of physicians practicing primary care full time, so I never really had a role model to look up to and help me envision myself in this field.
As a third year medical student, Savannah is only 1 year away from choosing what field of medicine she'll be pursuing. And based off of that interview, I suspect that primary care is not her top choice. Only about 22% of medical students actually end up practicing within three primary care fields: internal medicine, family medicine, and pediatrics. The other 78% pursue specialties. Savannah, if you weren't to pursue primary care, what specialty would you pursue and why?
As much as I would like to pursue primary care, I wouldn't be able to afford rent and pay back my loans because that field doesn't really pay much. So entering the field isn't a possibility for me. My second choice would be oncology. I've heard that oncology is one of the highest paid specialties. And with the number of student loans that I've had to take out, I need a specialty that will allow me to pay back that money.
Thank you so much for that amazing interview, Savannah. Tricia Wong will be covering the effects of a lack of primary care in a couple minutes. But right now, back to you, Nia.
Thanks so much, Clarisse, for that interview. Savannah is correct. According to the 2022 Medscape Physician Compensation Report, oncology is the 10th top earning specialty of the year, making an average of $411,000 a year.
Phew, if I was a doctor, I would go with the highest paying specialty, plastic surgery. Medscape reports that plastic surgeons are the number one top earning specialty with an average compensation of $576,000 a year. How do primary care physicians compare to those numbers, Nia?
Well, this graph shows just how different the salaries between primary care providers and specialists really are. As you can see, the bar representing PCPs is significantly lower than the bar representing specialists. From 2015 to 2022, there is consistently an approximate 100,000 difference between providers.
Why is this happening? Don't primary care providers and specialists get the same training during medical school? How can two students that have similar educations but end up earning such different salaries?
That is such an interesting question, Alexis. I believe that our financial expert, Clarisse Andrada, has just the interview to solve that question. Take it away, Clarisse.
We're on the field! Hey! We're on the field! Talking to random kids! We're on the field!
Welcome back to On the Field with Clarisse Andrada. You are so sweet, Nia, but very wrong. I'm outside 175 Hospital in the south sunny side of the valley of Las Vegas, Nevada, with Ms. Stephanie Copeland, their chief financial officer, and she is the real financial expert. Stephanie knows all about the ins and outs of reimbursement and physician compensation over at the hospital. Tell me, Ms. Copeland, why are primary care physicians paid so much less than specialists?
Well, you see, it's all based on the nature of each field of medicine. The way that most physicians are paid is through insurance reimbursement, and it's much easier to reimburse specialists who use more tangible materials like scalpels and medications than primary care physicians, who tend to only examine the patient and have a quick chat with them.
What about the primary care physicians who spend long periods of time with their patients? Some primary care providers claim to be spending over three times as much time with their patients as specialists, yet are compensated only about half of what those same specialists get. How do you compensate for time in physicians' compensation?
Well, with our current system, there isn't really a way to account for that. We use electronic health records to create a detailed list of what happens during a doctor's appointment. This system allows insurance to properly reimburse the hospital for everything used during the hospital visit. Having to factor in how meaningful the appointment is isn't really possible with our system.
We're on the field!
Thank you so much for that amazing interview, Ms. Copeland. So, I think that answers our question. The differences in compensation between primary care and specialists are due to the hospitals and insurance. I feel like that's a little unfair. How do you guys back in the studio feel?
I definitely feel like that's unfair. Sometimes you don't need any fancy equipment, just a little checkup. That doesn't mean that your doctor's appointment was any less meaningful than a surgery or a screening.
That interview was extremely eye-opening, and I definitely agree with you. Tricia Wong has more about the importance of primary care. But first, a word from our sponsors.
This is the hardest decision of my life.
Coming soon.
If I make the wrong choice,
this decision,
I'm screwed.
Is just,
I feel so betrayed.
Beginning. The Bachelorette Specialty Edition, airing tonight at 8, 7 Central.
Every day, a young child gets sick because there are not enough primary care physicians. The PCP shortage is affecting everyone in the United States, and we need you to help overcome this shortage and bring back a healthy lifestyle. Primary care physicians focus on general medicine, and they are usually the first stop when getting medical care. There are three types of primary care: family medicine, general internal medicine, and general pediatrics. In total, it takes 11 years to be a primary care physician, 4 years in an undergraduate program, 4 years in med school, and an additional 3 years of residency. Primary care physicians make sure patients are up to date with vaccines, find a specialist if needed, and suggest patients to get screenings like mammograms for breast cancer or pap smears for cervical cancer. They take a very preventative approach towards health, which is why they're an important part in healthcare. Primary care physicians are always in demand and have the opportunity to create worthwhile relationships with their patients. Last but not least, PCPs earn a salary of $200,000 a year. Clark County has a one primary care physician to every 1,760 patients. It needs to be changed now. Choose primary care today to help the nation return back to a healthy lifestyle.
I'm working for a zero wage. I went to med school and did really great. Still, I gotta make some cash. Residency's what I'm looking at. Since I have a degree, I will make a bigger salary. So now I've got to see which residency's right for me. I went on the internet and found the resident matching program. Filled out some questions to find out my direction. I'm training for my specialty at all times, getting so physician certified. National resident matching, match me with the right specialty.
Get matched to a specialty with national resident matching. Get matched to a specialty with national resident matching.
Is everyone around you depressed? Anxious? Are they unable to do the things they love? Do you want to help but don't really know how? Do your friends trauma dump on you and have you act like the therapist friend? There's actually a way for you to get paid and be considered a professional so you can help those around you. Psychiatry is a medical specialty that focuses on the diagnosis and treatment of mental disorders. Psychiatrists deal with people who struggle with mental health and those who struggle with substance abuse. There are various treatments psychiatrists can provide, and what makes them different from a psychologist is that they have the ability to prescribe medicine. To become a psychiatrist, one has to go through years of training. They must finish med school, pass the license exam to practice medicine, go through 4 years of residency, and then an additional 3 years of training. Then, to become certified, they must pass the board exam. The student can go into fields such as geriatric psychiatry, addiction psychiatry, or psychosomatic psychiatry. There are 45,000 psychiatrists in the US right now. However, there is a growing shortage. This needs to be fixed because mental health issues are rising at a fast pace. Start your career path in psychiatry today and make a change in someone's life. You may be the last person that can save them.
The experience of a lifetime is happening this weekend. The PCPs will be live and in concert at Allegiant Stadium. Primary care visits will be available after the concert in the hopes of improving our population's health and promoting the path of primary care to future medical students. The PCPs are the role model that primary care hopefuls have always wanted. Don't miss this once-in-a-lifetime experience to see the PCPs performing their top hits from their newest album, Don't Stop Attention. Come see about primary, vaccines, and their biggest hits, Choose Your Pair of Primary. Tickets go on sale at the end of this broadcast for the low, low price of $100.
Of course, all the plastics are in the same rotation. Wait, Damien. Wait, she's Damien. Jones. Don't. Johnson!
Jones.
Jones.
That's why she went into neurosurgery, so she could literally be in everyone's business.
Amber suffers from crippling depression. She spends all day sleeping in her bed, binging Netflix, and browsing YouTube. Her depression has caused a horrible relationship with her boyfriend, Nathan. She lives in the small town of Tonopah, and her only friends besides Nathan are the stuffed animals she sleeps with. Her mental health is at a low, and at the moment, she's even starting to catch a cold.
I'm sick of feeling sick, but this town has limited access to healthcare, and I don't feel like going out.
She then discovered telehealth. Now Amber seeks healthcare services and therapy through one-on-one consultations with her physician in the comfort and quiet of her own home.
Life changed after I started my teleconsultations. What can telemedicine do for you?
Doctor visits don't have to be the same for everybody, and getting care shouldn't mean having to get up.
Schedule a telehealth appointment today.
That new season of The Specialist is looking amazing! We'll have Leticia covering the show's final episode in just a few minutes. But right now, it's time to address the elephant in the room, the primary care shortage. As Clarisse said, the medical students of today are not as interested in the field. While things may feel fine right now, as the years go on, we'll feel the effects of the lack of primary care physicians immensely. Studies have found that states with a higher number of primary care physicians per 10,000 patients were overall healthier than states with a lower provider-patient ratio. These states were found to have lower rates of mortality, low birth rate, and obesity. The field of primary care is dedicated to primary and secondary prevention. Not only can regular primary care appointments ensure that the population is making healthy choices and staying immunized, but they can also prevent numerous types of cancer from progressing to a fatal state through early detection and annual screenings. Did you know that over 87% of mammograms are ordered by primary care physicians? Each mammogram ordered is another woman saved from breast cancer-related death. Without primary care physicians, numerous preventable diseases would be left untreated and raise our mortality rate. If we don't do something now, the results will be fatal. Not only is primary care effective in prevention, but it also tends to be cheaper. The preventative effects of primary care lead to a lower amount of hospitalizations, as populations with a higher provider-patient ratio are more likely to be healthier and in less need of hospital room visits. Primary care physicians also act as gatekeepers for the rest of the healthcare field, keeping patients from using more expensive specialists or the emergency room unless absolutely needed.
The benefits of primary care are clear. In order to keep the population healthy, we need primary care. It's a necessity. Although the benefits of this field of medicine are clear, we've seen a wave of med students rushing to pursue specialties. Alexis has more on that story later, but right now, we have an amazing performance by three primary care providers. I'm Tricia Wong with News HCA, and these are the PCPs.
Oh my god, that was an amazing performance, girls. What did you think about that, Leticia?
Truly inspiring. I mean, it definitely inspired me to pursue a career in internal, family, or pediatric medicine.
You know, I wish that medical students today were as inspired as you.
Oh my god, so do I. I mean, higher income, more predictable hours, and higher prestige are convincing young medical students to specialize. In fact, the new bachelor season has pivoted from its typical romantic contenders to specialties.
The Bachelorette Specialty Edition.
Welcome back to The Bachelorette Specialty Edition. Today, we are in the fabulous Las Vegas, Nevada, here to find a match for our newest bachelorette.
Introducing The Bachelorette.
Hi, my name is Brianna Rush. I am 26 years old, and today is residency match day! These past 4 years of my life have truly been life-changing, and I'm so excited to finally become an MD and choose my specialty.
Are there any specific specialties you're going to match into?
Well, I don't want to give anything away until the matching ceremony, but I'll just say this. I've definitely made one connection with a specialty.
Just one connection?
You know, this day is really important to me. If I make the wrong choice, I'm screwed.
Let's bring in the specialties.
My name is Family Medicine. I've been in the medical field for quite some time. I'm pretty much the original medical practice, and I don't intend on leaving anytime soon. There's always a demand for primary care providers, even though the supply isn't really meeting the demand at the moment.
Do you think Brianna's gonna pick you?
Do I hope that she does? Of course. Do I think that she will? Absolutely not. Only about 22% of med students actually go into primary care, and I don't think Brianna is part of that statistic.
Thank you.
I'm pediatrics, and I've been a specialty for about 200 years. I haven't really had the same privilege as other specialties that are growing at like super fast rates, but I guess that's okay since like birth rate is dropping and there aren't really as many kids to take care of. Still kind of sad. Honestly, I hope she does. Out of all the other specialties, I have the least amount of physicians.
Alright, bruh. You get us started with these introductions. I really need it though, but alright. What's up, guys? My name is Orthopedics. You know, I've been in this business for like 300 years, but people be saying I've been here since the Stone Age. I don't know why they say that, but I think so as well. You know, I'm in high demand right now. I also don't know why, but people be aging and their bad joints are everywhere, so I gotta do that. But hey, yo, what's up? Do you think she's gonna choose you type? You know what? I'm Orthopedics. I'm the best of the best. I know she'd love me anyways.
I'm emergency medicine. It's been about 60 years in the business for me. I'm quite a young specialty, but that doesn't mean I'm not capable. I'm very essential to the healthcare industry, even at my young age. Oh, sorry, I'm on call. What was the question again?
And now, the moment you've been waiting for, the matching ceremony.
Decision of my life. I never knew that I would be here.
Yes. The Bachelor's 28th season no longer includes the same narcissistic, wealthy, and perfect teeth individuals. Now, the show focuses on matching future positions with their residencies. Watch as the current Bachelorette turned MD, Brianna Rush, makes the decision of a lifetime.
I've had amazing memories with all of you, Orthopedics. You've taught me so much about myself. I can't imagine a life without you. And you make me so much money. Emergency medicine, you have brightened up my entire life in so many ways, and I really wish that you would be paying attention right now. Family medicine. Pediatrics? Yeah. Anyways, it's not you, it's just that I don't really see a future where we work out. I have no plans to pursue you, just like the other 80% of residents. Sorry, I'm basic. And you too. Orthopedics, will you accept this rose?
Heartwarming, wouldn't you say so, Leticia?
Oh my god, it's a match made in heaven! Brianna and Ortho will make an amazing pair.
That scene is similar to what match day looks like at medical schools across the country. Specialties are becoming increasingly attractive, but as Tricia said, the imbalance is causing problems.
Primary care physicians have been the major providers for minorities and people living in the rural areas, and the shortage is leaving the groups out to dry. Leticia Delgado has more on the story.
And I'll meet you guys back up there for the weather report. Thank you so much for that introduction, Alexis. Happy weekday, everybody. My name is Leticia, and I'm here on Skies with 175 to give you a report on rural access to primary care. And let me tell you, the outlook, it's looking cloudy.
It's time for the Skies with 175. I'm teaching you all the ways to thrive. Studying healthcare, reporting, baby. Oh, it's all right. Skies with 175. Skies with 175.
So it is no secret that medical students are choosing to specialize instead of going into primary care. From 1965 to 1992, the number of primary care physicians increased by 13%, while the number of specialists increased by 121%. But what does this forecast look like on a national map? This map depicts the number of primary care physicians in non-metropolitan areas based on their age. You'll find that physicians over the age of 75 are incredibly concentrated in rural areas. By contrast, only 0 to 3% of physicians under the age of 35 practice in these rural counties. Although non-metropolitan areas are disproportionately affected by the growing number of specialists, primary care physicians shortages are seen across the nation, indiscriminate of rural or urban counties. The following map depicts a different type of rainy day. As we move from northwest to southeast, you'll notice that we're not short of any medium blue or dark blue shapes. These show heavy concentrations of primary care shortages in each county. Now, if you don't take my word for it, Nia Cuasito, a good friend of mine, is currently live on the field, visiting Tonopah in the Big Smoky Valley. She'll show you just how barren the primary care landscape is right here in our Silver State.
We're on the field!
Thank you so much, Leticia. My name is Nia, and I'm here in Tonopah, Nevada. Approximately in the midway between Las Vegas and Reno, Tonopah is an unincorporated town in Nye County. As of 2020, the town is home to more than 2,000 people, a far cry from the bolstering 600,000 population of Las Vegas. The Nye County primary care provider to patient ratio is 3,023:1, so it's no surprise that accessing healthcare is a challenge here.
We're on the field!
Thank you so much, Nia, and let's make sure to get you some water. What a sore sight, guys. As we all know, every cloud has a silver lining, and we're in the Silver State. We hope to see improvements in healthcare access to Nevadans in the coming months. Up next, we have Tricia Wong with our movie critics segment. I'm Leticia with Skies with 175, and this has been The Rural Forecast.
Thank you, Leticia. This Friday, we have a new comedy movie hitting the theaters. Here we have Rebecca McHenry promoting her new movie, MD Girls. Let's run the clip.
In the name of all things holy, look at Katie Johnson's scrubs.
Across all the plastics are in the same rotation.
They're med school royalty. If medical school was a magazine, they'd always be on the cover.
That one right there, that's Katie Johnson, anesthesiology. He sat next to her in Chris with us.
She thought an IV was a type of plant.
See that little one? That's Jillian Wagner, neurology.
Totally rich because Medscape says neurosurgeons supposedly make the most money.
Jillian Wagner knows everybody's business. She knows everything about everyone.
That's why she went into neurosurgery, so she could literally be in everyone's business.
Hey, what's and happening? And Eagle, physician form, Alina Jones. Plastic surgery. Don't be fooled, because she may seem like a typical, selfish, toxic, and uneducated dirtbag, but in reality, she's so much more than that.
She's like an attending physician without two. The star. Those other two were just her little pawns and little workers.
Alina Jones. How do we even begin to explain
Alina Jones is flawless.
She only wears pig scrubs and has a good lip.
She thinks she's better than us just because she went to medical school.
I heard she made an intern cry on the very first day.
1 week, she made us work an extra 10 hours just so she could take a vacation in the Bahamas.
One time, she yelled at me for missing primary care. It was awful.
And that was an exclusive sneak peek of Indie Girls. It has received a certified fresh title on Rotten Tomatoes, so this movie is not one to miss. Now, Rebecca McHenry, can you tell us about a little bit about her character and about her specialty?
Of course I can. Alina is a doctor who specializes in plastic surgery. That's why the main group is called the Plastics. It's kind of a little wordplay. The group as a whole symbolizes the shine and glimmer that some people look at when looking at those specialties. While more people look at primary care like it's dirt. Janice and Damien. Anyways, plastic surgery is very in demand because of how broad it is. In fact, it's one of the most competitive specialties right now. People normally think that plastic surgery is just Botox and lip fillers, and they think of the Kardashians, but it's so much more than that. There are really essential plastic surgical procedures that we need in the healthcare system. Some scenes in the movie address just how innovative and constantly changing the field of plastic surgery really is.
I see. That's amazing to hear. I also heard that plastic surgery is taking over the world globally. Because of its intense demand, plastic surgery can also lessen the burden of disease. Some plastic surgery are needed to lessen the risk of disease getting worse.
That's correct. A child with a noma or a grown woman with an untreated cleft lip has a 90% mortality rate, and those who survive suffer from oral incontinence and facial disfigurement.
That's so sad to hear. Thankfully, though, more people are choosing to specialize in plastic surgery. Moving on to the movie, though, can you give us a little more insight about the plastics?
Yes, of course, I can do that. Katie is an anesthesiologist. They are responsible for things that go on before, during, and after the operation, like airway management, vital stabilization, and chronic pain management. So they're very essential to the healthcare system. Jillian is a neurologist, and she treats disease that can develop in the nervous system. They're very much in demand right now because residents really like to choose neurology as their specialty. It's very attractive to them. The same can be said for anesthesiology as well. That's why Katie and Jillian are up there on the hierarchy. They're on the top because those specialties are so coveted. And Regina, and Alina, me, is on top, of course.
Now, in the clip, we also see that Janice and Damien are primary care physicians. We also hear how Alina yelled at another worker just because they want to pursue primary care. Would you say that there's a little tension between the PCPs and specialists?
Yes, I would say that. You'd be right. There is a little tension between the two. It wasn't like that, but as time went on, the relationship between primary care physicians and specialists has drastically changed over time. One reason is that they don't really know each other as well as you would think. The only reason why they collaborate and interact with each other is when the primary care physician is sending over their patient's health records to the specialist. Other than that, they really are just strangers. They don't interact as much.
I've also heard that the lack of collaboration contributes to lack of communication between PCPs and specialists, which then eventually results in a bigger margin of error. Now, one last question for you, Rebecca. What is gatekeeping model, and does that contribute to the relationship at all?
I am so glad you asked that question. The gatekeeping model is when patients aren't able to see a specialist or go to the hospital without the referral of their primary care provider. Many people argue that this mechanism is just a way to deny the health care that when it really prevents unnecessary procedures. However, lots of PCPs take advantage of this and they don't even send their patients to a specialist at all, and rather just ignore those needs. They decide whether it's necessary or not, and the patients have no choice but to listen. They can't go past their PCP's decision. That really places a huge dent in the relationship between primary care physicians and specialists, to be honest. And honestly, I totally get why Alina yelled at that worker. She probably deserved it.
Well, that will be all for today. Thank you, Alina, for joining us. And make sure to watch MD Girls, of course, at the theater near you.
Thank you for having me here.
Now, let's take a little break from movies and move on to Sports Court, where we hear highlights from last night's game between MDs and DOs with Leticia and Alexis. Later on, we'll be discussing Twilight, an angsty story between Penelope and Grace Madison Efron.
Thank you so much for that introduction, Tricia. My name is Leticia, and I'm here with one of our most knowledgeable anchors on medical matches, Alexis. Today, we're covering the anticipated MD versus DO game. Two degrees faced off in a spectacular basketball game, leaving us stunned at their level of skill. The HCA 175 Sports Court is delighted to have Alexis with us today for the rundown.
It's a pleasure to be here, Leticia. The game between the two rivals, the MDs and the DOs, was truly not one to be missed. It was an incredibly close game, but at the end, with a score of 117 to 116, the MDs came on top, which is expected of the highly respected team.
You know, it does seem that the DOs played very hard tonight. It just wasn't enough. While watching the game, though, I can't help but notice that both of the degrees have very different play styles. I mean, there's probably a reason for that, right?
You're right, Leticia. The DOs practice very differently from the MDs. They focus on osteopathic medicine and have probably spent 300 hours solely focusing on osteopathic manipulation training. They focus on the musculoskeletal system and stress preventive measures. They're also very holistic compared to MDs.
Oh, you know, I find that very interesting. I find the MDs very interesting, in my opinion. They focus on allopathic medicine. That means that they're rather curative instead of preventative, like the DOs. That's why I think that they're a force to be reckoned with on the field. Their practice is much more useful because the majority of the plays are allopathic in nature.
Mm-hmm. I would also like to mention that the MDs and DOs have different qualifications as well. The DOs take the comprehensive osteopathic medical licensing examination to be qualified as a team, and the MDs, on the other hand, take the United States medical licensing examination.
Wow, okay, so, you know, they say that if you have different tests, you're going to have different results. And if we look at the stats from last night's game, couldn't be any truer. It says here that 57% of the DOs took general shots, like a regular two-pointer or a free throw. The MDs, on the other hand, less than 30% of their shots are considered general.
Mm-hmm. Yes, the MDs are a much more flashier team than the DOs. They specialize and try their best to avoid the primary moves. That's why the MDs take much more three-point attempts, dunks, and alley-oops. The MDs are a much more regressive team than the DOs. That's why they get paid more. An average MD salary is $200,000, which is $40,000 more than the average DO salary.
Goodness, goodness, I don't know what I'd do with that much money. It looks like the MDs were destined to win this game after hearing all of that. However, I would like to bring up their practice facilities. The DOs practice sites are found in more rural areas, while MDs are found in urban areas. You know, I've got to give kudos to the DOs because I've heard that they provide health resources to those in need.
That's right. Those rural areas have a hard time accessing health resources, so the DOs open up as many practice sites as they can in hopes to improve this issue. While they have lost the game, they have certainly won our hearts.
I couldn't have said it any better, Alexis. You know, it doesn't really matter what you do on the court as much as what matters what you do off the court. Alexis, thank you so much for joining me to talk about last night's exhilarating game. It's definitely one for the history books. Now, this has been Leticia Delgado on Sports Courts, and let's return to movie critics after this commercial break.
This is your heart. Like every other organ in your body, it needs to be taken care of. It is one of the strongest muscles, as it does one of the main jobs, to pump blood throughout your body. However, your heart can run into some issues. You can become victim to heart disease. Luckily for you, there are cardiologists available to help. Cardiologists specialize in the cardiovascular system and are qualified to treat any issues with the heart. To make a diagnosis, they run multiple tests, like an electrocardiogram and blood tests. They also take a preventative approach, like suggesting patients to alter their lifestyle and manage their weight. Cardiologists are very well respected because of their hard work that they put into becoming them. It takes at least 10 years for them to become certified. 4 years of med school, 3 years of training in internal medicine, 3 years of medical training specific to cardiology, and finally pass an exam given by the American Board of Internal Medicine. There are many reasons to see a cardiologist. Shortness of breath, dizziness, fainting spells, chest pains, and heart flutters are all associated with the heart. See a cardiologist if you're experiencing any of these issues. Or maybe you can become a cardiologist yourself. The choice is yours.
This is Elise. Elise spends her days ignoring health issues until they worsen, bouncing between specialists, filling up emergency rooms, and living in this lack of primary care world. But then, Elise made the switch. With the patient-centered medical home model, personal comprehensive care plans holistically address Elise's needs using a team of coordinated health providers. And most importantly, primary care is emphasized the most.
I would describe my primary care provider as the captain of the ship.
Don't take her word for it. People from all walks of life benefit from this care model.
You know, before trying out the patient-centered home model, I didn't even know my doctor's name. From my physical health to my mental health, my team of doctors care about it all.
So, what are you waiting for? The National Committee for Quality Assurance has accredited more than 10,000 practices as quality patient-centered medical home sources. Because if it's not patient-centered, then who is it centered around? Make that switch today. A recent study concluded that patients cared for under patient-centered medical homes had less total health expenditures than those cared for by non-patient-centered medical homes. However, none of these findings reached statistical significance to determine whether or not patient-centered medical homes are superior. Talk to your doctor about what care model is right for you.
Fun fact, radiologists literally look at the inside of your body. I'm not joking, they see your insides. Don't worry, radiologists don't literally open you up. They do it through a series of tests. To name a few tests and procedures, radiologists conduct mammograms, CT scans, MRIs, PET scans, and ultrasounds. Do not be afraid of them, they are certified to do the job. Those who want to study radiology will have to go through many years of education and training to be able to qualify. They must go through 4 years of undergraduate school, 4 years of med school, a 1 year internship, and 4 years of residency. Even when students finish residency, they are still not done receiving training. Depending on which field they want to go to, it's an additional 1 year until they can become professionals. If you ask me, I'll trust them very much. No wonder why they make $427,000 a year. Radiologists may be the only ones who can solve what's wrong with you. They interpret the results of the tests and procedures stated before, and is able to refer you to other care providers in hopes to give you the best possible care. Even though they can basically see your brain, they sadly can't find out why you have crippling depression. But they can find out if you're pregnant. See a radiologist today. If you're up to the challenge, maybe even become one. We'll see where the future takes you.
What would you do for an RTT?
You're the CEO of a hospital, right?
Yes, I am.
So what would you do for an RTT?
What would I do for an RTT? Well, first, I would definitely ensure that we had accreditation. We would be accredited by the Accreditation Council of Graduate Medical Education. Then after that, I would ensure that our residents did more than half of their training at rural hospitals or non-hospital rural sites. And then after that, we would establish our rural training track cap in about 5 years and get even extra federal assistance for training our residents. Was that not the correct answer? Oh no. So for an RTT, I would jump out of an airplane for an RTT.
For that shortage solving program, increasing rural physicians by the minute, what would you do for an RTT?
Emergency alert. This is an emergency alert. This just in. Dr. Kruger, a former doctor at 330 Hospital, has been accused of medical malpractice and the death of an innocent girl. This is security camera footage found at the scene of the crime.
That mulligan coming up from Dr. Betty's class. Oh my god, are you okay?
Oh no, is she okay?
I don't
anyone know CPR? The CPR? Is there a doctor in the area? I'm on my break.
Last seen outside the hospital wearing a white coat, Dr. Kruger has fled arrest and is currently on the run, undercover. Experts claim that Dr. Kruger's malpractice has been due to the primary care shortage, with many specialists being unable to practice defense medicine protocols like regular primary care physician appointments. The HCA Police Department is closely investigating the crime and the witnesses involved. If you or anyone you know has intel on the whereabouts of Dr. Kruger, please call the number on your screen immediately. This was an emergency alert.
That game between the MDs and the DOs has got me hooked. What about you, Nia?
It was so intriguing. We have another movie critic segment coming in for you. The sixth installment of Twilight has shifted gears to depict Penelope Crowe's struggle as a primary care physician with graduate medical education. Let's roll the clip now.
Is pregnant, and she told her boyfriend that it's his because they were like, yeah, but it's actually his best friend. So now he doesn't know that she has cheated on him, and it's this whole thing.
Move over, primary care.
Orthopedics in the house!
I guess I'll go to my seat.
Hello, I didn't introduce myself last week. I'm Grace Madison Efron. I'm a graduate medical education program. You must be Penelope Crowe. I heard about you before. You're the new primary care physician, right?
Yeah. Alrighty, class, so today we're gonna be talking about the primary care shortage. Don't look too excited, okay? So just start by conversing with all of your little classmates for today, okay? Oh, come on, guys. You guys must like each other a little bit, right?
Brother.
Whatever. Just fill out the paper that's in front of you. Turn it in by the end of class.
You can go first. Where were you?
I don't know what you mean. I've always been here.
The state of California could be down by as many as 10,000 primary care providers. Primary care is struggling. I don't think you were always here.
Actually, graduate medical programs like me help further education of physicians. I'm here to help.
Enjoying your work so far?
You're asking me about my work?
I guess I am.
I don't really like being lost or anything like that, if that answers your question. There's no guidance for primary care providers like me. What?
Nah, it's nothing. The American Academy of Failing Physicians is constantly funding higher education programs. These programs create residency opportunities, and they address the imbalances of rural and urban areas. They actually increase primary care providers and help undeserved areas. There's plenty of guidance in the GME programs. You just have to check it.
Do you mind if I check?
No, I don't mind.
You're right.
Like I said, Anyways, why did you become a primary care physician if you didn't know anything about GME programs?
I heard there was a shortage and thought I could enter the field, but I wasn't fully prepared for it during school.
You should look into the Teaching Health Center GME program. It actually funds the program that will train the next generation of physicians. The THC GME program has trained over 1,000 physicians and dentists since it started in 2001. And actually, 65% of those trainees, they are actually family physicians. But you can check it if you want.
I believe you.
Well, if you ever need help, I'll always be here.
So Alexis, how do we feel about this segment?
Well, it sure is something. The intensity and chemistry between the actors in the scene sure made me have goosebumps. How do you feel about this segment, Nia?
It was highly informative as well. Who knew how beneficial GME programs were to primary care providers?
I definitely didn't.
Mm-hmm. Oh?
Oh, really? Oh, that's crazy. Okay.
Who was that?
That was an emergency call from the Teaching Health Center GME program. They need help. Let's put them on the screen.
Hi, thank you so much for having me on tonight. I'm sure you're aware of the dire situation we're in.
Of course. We've had several news stories about the current state of the primary care field.
And then you should also know that our program is set to expire come 2023.
We actually didn't know that, but thanks for letting us know. But why did you have to call us so urgently?
Well, without funding, our program isn't able to train the next generation of primary care physicians, and this can worsen the shortage. Luckily, there is a solution. The DOC Act is being shown at Congress.
That sounds so cool. What does it do?
Oh, it's amazing. The DOC Act will enable the government to give $500 million to training our physicians. We could train over 1,500 with those.
Wow, that money could help fix the primary care shortage. We learned about how important GME is for primary care providers in that Twilight movie.
So now you understand why I had to call the station so urgently. We really want as many Twilight supporters as there were to also be DOC Act supporters. In truth, participating in your legislation is a great way to support healthcare, and I've prepared a few tips to help the audience do just that. To begin, it's really important to do your homework. While the diagram on screen is a bit oversimplified, it shows that there's roughly 7 steps a bill must take to become a law. The DOC Act is currently in its second step, I believe, as it was only introduced on June 6, 2022. It was then referred to the Subcommittee of House Energy and Health Commerce, and it has been read twice. Now, while we're greatly anticipating these passages, we have to understand that the preliminary stages give you, the audience, the opportunity to participate in its success. A great way to support the DOC Act is by understanding who's co-sponsoring it and who isn't. Let's find out who supports the bill. These are the 17 current co-sponsors of the bill. A co-sponsor is a representative or a senator that adds their name to the list and proudly says that they're in support of whatever the law wants to do. From California to Vermont, there are plenty of states in support of the DOC Act. Now, if you don't see your state on this screen, or you feel like there could be more representatives in your state, then you should totally write to your legislators. Writing to your representatives, your governors, or other legislators is a great way to participate in democracy. When drafting your letter, always address your legislator as the Honorable and be genuine. You should of course be courteous and legible, but truly let them know how you feel. Now, while my friends at the Teaching GME Center are incredibly occupied with making sure that the DOC Act gets passed, I did want to refer you to another bill, the Healthcare Improvement Act of 2022, to support as well. This bill aims to expand Medicaid, it wants to provide a public health insurance option, and it also wants to expand premium assistance. So you can follow these same steps to support that bill as well.
We totally get it. Thanks for that insight, THCGME.
Thank you so much for having me on HCA 175 News. I really appreciate it, and let's hope that this bill gets passed.
You know, Nia, that intervention made me think of something. Normally, when regular people think about doctors, they think of just that, doctors. But the medical field is so much more than that.
There are so many factors that come into the play in the field of medicine. Location, socioeconomic status, your insurance. I actually think Tricia has more information on that.
The newest movie musical, The Greatest Physician, is taking the world by storm for its insightful perspective on the relationship between primary care physicians and the current healthcare system. We have the cast of the movie with us today for a special performance.
You know I want you. It's not a secret I try to hide. I know you want me. So don't keep saying that there's no guide. You claim it's not in the pay, and fate is pulling you miles away and out of reach from me. But you're here in my ground, so who can stop you if you decide to join the primaries? What if we rewrite the rules? Say you were made to be mine. We gotta put everyone in school. Primary care is the one to find. It's up to you, and it's up to me. No one could see what we get to be. So why don't we rewrite the rules? And maybe the job could be yours tonight.
I think it's easy. You think I don't want to run to you, but there are shortages, and there are many lifestyle issues. I know you're wondering why, because we're able to be just you and me in rural areas. But when we go within, you're gonna wake up and see how good primary care is. No one can rewrite the rules. How can you say you'll be mine? The system is oh so cruel, and I'm not the one you are meant to find. It's not up to you, it's not up to me, when everyone tells us what we can be. So how can we rewrite the rules? Say that the job can be.
All I want is to work with you, but the system won't work with us. So let's face the system now.
It feels impossible.
It's not impossible.
Say that it's possible.
Say that it's possible. How do we rewrite the rules? Say you were made to be mine.
We gotta put it.
Cause you are the one I was meant to find. It's up to you, and it's up to me. No one could say what we get to be. And why don't we rewrite the rules? Taking the shortage decline.
You know I want you. It's not a secret I try to hide. But I can't have you. The system's broken, my hands are tied.
That scene depicts how primary care providers are in the constant fight with the U.S. healthcare system. The current system favors clinical procedures and short-term health rather than patient satisfaction and long-term health that is commonly associated with primary care.
As the song said, we need to rewrite the rules of the healthcare system to better cater towards primary care. This can include changing reimbursement for primary care visits and reinventing the electronic healthcare record systems that are used in the medical field.
Leticia, those are great ideas. You almost call them solutions.
It's time for your favorite segment of our show, the HCA Solution Squad.
Solution Squad!
If there's something strange in your neighborhood, who you gonna call?
Solution Squad!
If there's something weird
you gonna call?
Solution Squad!
That's right, Nia. After all of the problems we've discussed, it's time to finally solve them.
Remember Savannah Daniel? We have our Solution Squad outside her dorm right now with a sack full of surprises. Let's see what they're up to.
Solution Squad!
Earlier during our interview, Savannah expressed that she was not able to pursue primary care even though she really wanted to because of her student loans. So in order to fix the primary care shortage, we have decided to raise over $50,000 for her to pay off her student loans and go into primary care.
Let's give it to her now.
What are you doing here?
Hi, I'm Clarisse Andrada with the News HCA Solution Squad. We're here to give you a present. Can we come in?
Yes, of course.
So, everybody at the studio has found out about your troubles with primary care and has decided to raise over $50,000 for you to pay off your student loans. How did this make you feel?
It feels incredible. Oh my God, thank you guys so much. Thanks to the kind souls at News HCA, I'm definitely gonna be able to pay back my loans with this. Thank you guys so much.
So good. Back to the studio.
Solution Squad!
That is so sweet.
I agree. And that's only the beginning of this round of giving. Now, on a not so happy note, more details have been released on the malpractice investigation of 330 Hospital earlier in the show. Officers this afternoon received an anonymous tip that led to the arrest of Dr. Kruger and multiple other board members of 330 Hospital. They were hiding out inside classrooms here at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, most likely trying to avoid arrest.
Solution Squad!
Okay.
Rolling!
You know, we had heard that there was like a doctor like doing a bunch of bad things, but I never thought I'd see that guy in person. Or was it a guy or a girl?
I have no idea, but all I know is that was crazy. I hope that ends up on World Star or something.
Yeah, for sure. It was like insane. Like they were like running around and then they fell to the ground and I don't know, like I have to see the footage or something because it was insane.
Did you think that was a cop arresting the doctor?
Oh yeah, oh, I don't know. You know, it looks like that one news anchor. What's her name?
Trisha.
Yeah, I don't know what she's doing arresting people, but she did a good job.
Is she qualified?
Yeah, is she?
Solution Squad!
Now back to some more happy giving. Earlier in the show, we interviewed Stephanie Copeland, Chief Financial Officer of 175 Hospital, and she explained how their hospital's EHR system wasn't suited for primary care. We have our Solution Squad in the front of the hospital with another gift.
Solution Squad!
Dr. Copeland, hi. My name is Leticia Delgado, and I'm here with the News HCA Solution Squad. The team at the studio heard your complaints about your current healthcare medical system for your hospital, and we decided to help you out by gifting you a brand new electronic record system. So this EHR is perfectly suited for primary care providers. It's designed with user-friendliness in mind and enhances the abilities of primary care providers for getting like reimbursed without all those complicated programs that don't really help anybody. Thank you. This will help my hospital a lot. If we implement this new and improved system into my hospital, my primary care providers will be able to get a larger fee reimbursed from insurance companies and higher pay.
We're so happy we could help you out. All in a day's work at the HCA Solution Squad.
Solution Squad!
The Solution Squad really helps our community so much. I can't imagine how happy the workers at 175 Hospital are feeling right now.
What if the Solution Squad helped the entire country?
You don't mean...
Take it away, Solution Squad!
Solution Squad!
We are outside the Congress building! Can you believe it?
We did it! We did it, guys! We got the DOC Act passed to the presidential desk!
Well, technically we didn't do it though. It's thanks to our dedicated community-driven audience that wrote letters to the legislators. The House actually made a decision.
This bill getting passed would help so many people, primary care providers and patients alike.
I think that the Solution Squad has done their job. We'll meet you at the studio.
Solution Squad!
And that's it for today's News HCA broadcast. Although the primary care physician shortage is concerning, with a little encouragement during medical school, reinvention of the healthcare system, and federal intervention, we can solve the shortage. My name is Nia Cuasito.
I'm Alexis Lualhati.
I'm Leticia Delgado.
I'm Clarisse Andrada.
And I'm Tricia Wong. And we are
News HCA.
I can't say.
Can you see the orange chart?
Yeah.
Oi!
Wait, do I look over?
Oh!
What is that?
This! Oh my gosh, I keep missing that.
Oh, please, I'm a star! Please, I'm a star!
Scene. Emergency med. Confessional, take one. Scene 14, take 4.
Take it away, Solution Squad.
Beat him up.
Up next, we have Tricia Wong with our movie critics segment.
Okay, hold up.
Say it.
That's correct, Jason. Good job. I need you to get it wrong.
Oh, for real?
26 years old and
no.
Oh my, that was amazing, girls!
Hi. This day is really important to me. If I make the wrong choice, I'm screwed.
Thank you. This will help my hospital so much. Now my primary care providers will be able to get a higher reimbursement fee.
than states with a lower part.
Oh my god!
They have a solution squad for HCA.
Something.
Yeah,
wait, hold on.
Use HCA.
Yeah!